The American Dilemma, Chapter 19. I don't know if you read the directions or the instructions on how to do this chapter, but if you did, the first instruction said you didn't really have to read this chapter. It's not going to hurt you. It would probably help you if you did. But after reading the chapter myself a second time, this chapter is a perfect chapter for discussion. There's a lot of questions asked, like questions of economic disparity. Is the culture or the race to blame for the disparity? Is environmental into it? Should the black race assimilate with the white race, or should there be some distinctiveness? Does democracy really require uniformity? And if it did, we'd all be a boring place to live. And even the black scholars cannot agree. But one thing we do know, that distinctiveness equals no racial equality. Then this question's brought up, could the black race even ever assemble into the white race? Do they even want to? And like I can't repeat enough, the black scholars can't even agree what to do. This is a beautiful chapter for class discussion. And yes, we could have discussions online, but it's so unsatisfactory. By the time you type what you want to say, somebody else is saying something, and you've just never been fond of it. So I would suggest that you scan through the chapter and listen to the lecture, because I'm going to give you everything you need to know in the lecture. And the questions will come from the lecture instead of the text. That being said, I've got some information that was in the text in the lecture, but most of it I have gotten from other sources, and it's mine. And I want to start with education. You know, immediately after the Civil War, education had become a top priority to the newly freed blacks. Old, young, male, and female, they all flocked to any word they could get to read. And in the white public in the South, they seemed to accept it, at least not view it as a threat. But by the end of the 19th century, white supremacy is on the rise. Segregation is the watchword in the South and the North. And educational opportunities seem to be slipping away from the black man. And depriving the black schools of funding caused schools to be closed. And those that were open had inadequate facilities and teachers that were not very well trained, and it's going to remain like that to the middle of the 20th century. With the movement of so many blacks to the North, there were some, and I repeat, some improvement for the black student. But in the South, there was a large disparity of the money spent between black and white education. If it hadn't been for the work of the Julius Rosenwald Fund, there wouldn't have been as many new schools built as there were. There were some 5,000 built in 15 different southern states between 1913 and 1932. And of those, 36% was from the Rosenwald Fund and contributions of other white and black citizens. But even so, the per capita of investment in equipment for the black student was only about 15% of what was spent on the white student. But strange as it may seem, the salaries were almost equal between the black teachers and white teachers. But the Depression, the Great Depression, or the downturn in our economy, no matter what it was called, it was disastrous to the black education. In the South, construction on new schools stopped entirely. Teachers were laid off, and salaries were lowered, and, of course, tax expenditures were cut because there wasn't any money coming in. But the Northern communities, well, they were enlightened, you know. After all, it was the North that forced the end of slavery, remember? But they didn't approve of slavery, but they did approve of segregation. And in all fairness, it wasn't just for the blacks. It was anyone who was not WASP, or white, Anglo-Saxon, and Protestant, who'd be forced to live in separate areas. And of course, schools would be built in areas where there's housing. And that would have the effect of having the people who live in the area go to the schools in their area. Now, okay, if only black and brown lived in the area, then the school would be one color, wouldn't it? It wasn't said you couldn't go to other schools, but the rule stated that you were to go to the school in the area you lived in. Now, if you happened to live close to an all-white school, well, you would be encouraged to attend a school of your own kind. So even without trying to pass laws, they wound up with segregated schools. But in fairness, in 1900, New York State prohibited separate schools, and in New Jersey and Ohio and Illinois and Indiana, there were some integrated schools. In the large cities like Gary, Indiana, and Indianapolis, they were perfect examples of separate high schools, but they were modern and well-constructed. The teachers were well-trained, And it was a very successful attempt to have equal education. But no matter what label you put on it, it was segregation. Unfortunately, not only the parents, but the students also protested when there was any attempt to mix races in school. And what's that old proverb say, that the fruit doesn't fall far from the tree? So when the parent is a narrow-minded bigot, so the children will be. Now, if you've learned nothing else in the past few weeks, you will have learned the determination of the black race to receive an education. It seems no matter what barriers that were thrown up, black people continued to climb over them. And it wasn't just elementary or high school education they wanted higher education. And the number of black colleges grew. Now, there were three types of black colleges. There were the church, private, and public. And surprise, surprise, in some of the states, they began to contribute and even take over some of the church colleges. But it was after World War I that there was a steady increase in enrollment in universities and colleges. In the 1920s, the black students began to make demands. They wanted to get rid of all those old Victorian codes that regulated campus life. They wanted more diversity in their curriculum, like black history. And they wanted more black faculty. But part of the problem lay with, there's a decreased monies available. And with funds in short supply, several of the colleges even combined themselves. And overhead expenses were high and were not going to go down. So in 1943, Frederick Patterson, who was president of the Tuskegee Institute at that time, he had the idea that black universities should pool their money-making efforts and organize one giant fund. It was going to be called the United Negro College Fund. And once it got started, even rich white men such as Rockefeller kept the annual campaigns. And you can still see their efforts in public service announcements on TV, like a black mind is a terrible thing to waste. Now, before World War II, it was extremely unusual to see a black student attending an all-white college. And if you did, you can bet it would be in the North. But between 1960 and 1977, there was a steady increase in black enrollment in predominantly white colleges. But after 77, there was a decrease each year, and we do not know why. By 1984, the enrollment had dropped from a high of 1 + 1 1/10 million to a little over 900,000. And of those, some 250,000 were historically black colleges. In the mid-1940s, the administrators of black colleges had been white. But in 1965, the all-black colleges had black administrators. And in 1970, lo and behold, a black president of a white college, Michigan State University. And that man's name is worth knowing, Clifton Wharton. He went on to become the chancellor of the 90 campuses at the State University of New York. A white man, a black man in charge of a white college, that is a giant step forward. Mary Frances Berry became the chancellor of the University of Colorado, and Marguerite Ross Barnett, the chancellor of the University of Missouri, St. Louis. And Dr. Barnett went on to become the president of the University of Houston. And why do I have these mentioned? Because I am a sexist and they're women. The number of black professors is growing because of the demand for teachers of black studies. And we begin to see the presence of black teachers in all colleges. But one thing they were unable to do was to achieve tenure. It's still hard to do. Not being satisfied with just a bachelor's degree, many black graduates wanted graduate schooling in order to further their employment opportunities. Now, in the early part of the 20th century, graduate training was available in a very few northern and private schools. But after 1945, the demand grew and a way to provide the opportunity had to be provided. Well, one method was send the black applicant to a northern school. But what if she or he couldn't afford it? Well, there's always lawsuits. And for instance, in 1936, a Lloyd Gaines tried to get into the University of Missouri. When he was refused, he took his case to the state courts, which he lost. He went to the local federal court, and he lost. And finally, to the Supreme Court. And Chief Justice Hughes ruled that it was the duty of the state to provide education for all its citizens, and the provisions must be made within the state. He further stated that to provide for the white residents and not the blacks is a denial of the equality of legal right to the enjoyment of the privilege. Oh, wow. I tell you, that decision. To say it cast ripples throughout the higher education community would be an understatement. They'd been concerned for years, but nothing had been done. Now there was a rush to either build separate but equal schools for graduate studies or make provisions for black attendance. It's with irony that it was the white community that gave the most support to having local or regional graduate study centers for the blacks in 1945. In Oklahoma, the issue really heated up. An applicant to the law school of the University of Oklahoma was provided with separate facilities. Well, she refused to go to them. And finally, 4 years later, she was admitted and allowed not to be segregated. But another black Oklahoman granted permission to attend the graduate department. And he was segregated in the library, in the classroom, in the cafeteria, and he sued, rightfully so. And the ruling came back to end segregation. And it spilled over into Texas. The Supreme Court ruled there that a separate law school for black students would not give them the same education as a white law student. Well, now, wait a minute. What about Plessy v. Ferguson, that separate but equal ruling back in the 1890s? Well, by the late 1940s, it had become obvious to the white Southerner that the higher education being integrated, it was only a short hop and skip and a jump until the elementary and secondary school would be ruled to have to integrate. So a building program is starting. It's going to forestall any legal action, they think. And better schools for the black students. It's too little too late. In 1951, the NAACP had decided to challenge the legality of segregated schools. In 1954, in a case called Brown v. Board of Education, the Supreme Court ruled that segregated public schools was illegal. So after 58 years, is it going to be over? Let's talk just a few minutes about Brown v. Board of Education. It was a class action. Brown was just the name that was chosen to head the list. There was quite a few of them involved. But Brown was a minister in Topeka, and his house was about two blocks from a white school. Yet when he tried to enroll his little girl in a white school, they said no, because she's black. So she would be forced to walk all the way through a railroad changing yard, which is very dangerous, to even catch a bus to get to the black school. Willie got mad, so he went to the NAACP and said, let's do something about it. And he happened to be in at the same time that they decided they're going to do something. The NAACP, its chief lawyer was Thurgood Marshall. They decided to use the Brown case to challenge the separability principle in the Topeka. They sued the Topeka Board of Education for not allowing Linda Brown, his daughter, to attend summer elementary school, an all-white school. Any other cases involved were similar suits by black parents from other parts of the country. And Marshall attacked that separate but equal rule, and he argued that segregation harms minority students and makes them feel inferior and thus interfering with their ability to learn. Sure does. And in a unanimous decision, the Supreme Court very rarely does this, but in unanimous decision, they agreed with Marshall and declared that the separate educational facilities could never be equal. Therefore, the segregation in the schools violated the 14th Amendment, stating that all citizens must be treated equally. Wow. Problem solved, right? Oh, no, 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 no. Southern schools are still not admitting blacks. In public schools, many new private schools are established. There's many court cases, forceful entry, which we get more into in the civil rights movement. But in the 1970s, the courts in the United States, in their infinite wisdom, ordered some cities to begin busing the students between neighborhoods, mainly to integrate the schools. It did help integrate some of the schools, but it wasn't working. It was causing more hardship to students. Didn't like having to get up the idea of getting up and going on a bus. It just wasn't working. In the 1970s, President Nixon eliminated it. Okay. When we think of a public library, we automatically assume it's open to all people, regardless of their status of citizenship or residence. And I personally visited libraries in cities that I was visiting. I didn't check any books out, but I did have the use of all the materials in the building. But libraries was another institution that was segregated in the South. As late as 1935, there were only 83 out of 565 libraries in 13 Southern states that allowed African Americans to even come in the front door. And with all that segregation, all that discrimination, the lack of schools available, there evolved a large number of highly trained black men and women. men and women who are going to become regarded as experts in their fields. Men and women are going to have their works published in previously all-white professional journals. And they're even publishing their own black journals. There were experts in sociology. W.E.B. Du Bois is no longer alone. We got experts in economics and the social studies and humanities and the scientific fields. And although there is a list as long as your arm, I'm only going to talk to you about three. The first one is one you heard about when you were in school. George Washington Carver. Yes, this is a picture of him when he's a little bit older. Carter was born a slave on a farm near Diamond, Missouri. Right after he was born, his father was killed in an accident and his mother was kidnapped. So he was reared by a Moses and Susan Carver, white, and they owned him until slavery was abolished. But as a young boy, he was a pleasant boy to be around. He enjoyed plants, and he had this great desire to learn to read. And so the Carvers taught him how to read and write. And when he was 11 years old, he was sent to a school for black children. And for the next 20 years, he worked various jobs to support himself and pay for his education. In 1890, he entered the Simpson College in Iowa. He'd gone in to become a painter. But once he got enrolled in college and started taking courses, he thought maybe he'd like to do something to help African Americans in the South. So most of them worked on farms. So he transferred to the Iowa State Agricultural College and received a bachelor's degree in agriculture in 1894. And then 2 years later, he received his master's degree. With his master's degree hot in his hand, ink still wet, he passed down to his Tuskegee Institute and applies for a job and was hired to become the head of the Tuskegee Agricultural Department and director of a state agricultural program. He directed his attention in the early years to soil conservation and ways to improve the crops. He would write pamphlets and bulletins and he would distribute them. He would talk to people. He'd even go to other states. He tried to teach them how to be more productive in their practices, particularly the black farmers, but he talked to white farmers. He had traveling exhibits, and he had demonstrations, and he lectured. 1910, he was promoted to head of the Tuskegee newly created Department of Research, and in 1914, he finally began to focus on peanuts. He received national attention in 1921 when he testified before a committee of the Congress in support of a tariff tax on imported peanuts. He gave lectures on peanuts throughout much of the country. He worked also to improve race relations. He was very active in the work for the Commission on the Interracial Cooperation and the Young Men's Christian Association. He never married. In 1940, he gave his life savings of $33,000, which doesn't sound like much in today's time, but if you multiply that by 14, you probably have what it was close to here. He died, as I say, in 1940. I never married. He made more than 300 different products from peanuts. One of them was a milk substitute, and there was a face powder, and there was printer's ink and soap. He also created 75 products from pecans, or pecans, depending on what area of the country you're from, and more than 100 different products from sweet potatoes. And from sweet potatoes, he made flour, shoe polish, and candy. He even came up with a synthetic marble made from wood shavings. His mind was never still. It was always going full tilt. And with his research and his educational methods, he managed to convince a lot of the black farmers to grow peanuts instead of cotton. And it gave some of them a better source of income. Now, I have done quite a bit of research on Mr. Washington, and he was a brilliant man. But he was not a very friendly man. He was a little bit cold and distant, if you want to know the truth. I think that's why he never married. There wasn't a woman around to put up with him. And you've never heard... Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot to put this up here. Work to improve. Okay. Mersey Tate. Yeah. Let me tell you a bit about this exceptional woman. Her great grandparents were actual pioneers in the 19th century. They migrated in a covered wagon from eastern Ohio to the wildness of central Michigan, where black families were beginning to settle because they were able to take advantage of the Homestead Act of 1862 and they got some land. And they, like the white settlers, they felled trees, they built long houses and barns and schools and churches and log fences. But she came from a rather hardy stock. And she was born on February the 6th, 1905, in the middle of a blizzard. And believe me, blizzards in Michigan blow like crazy. But the local country doctor was not able to drive his horse and sled through the snow, so a German neighbor helped with the delivery. And the German neighbor didn't fill out any paperwork. So when the doctor finally got there the next day, he filled out the certificate of birth. And because Mersey was very light skinned, he recorded the birth as a white female. And this, shall we say, caused some minor complications when Mersey applied for a passport to go abroad to study. But as a child, she attended a log schoolhouse. It was not painted red, by the way. It was painted white. And in Michigan at this time, it was a custom that there would be a schoolhouse every 4 miles and on a surveyed dirt and gravel road, that no child should have to walk more than 2 miles to go to school. And the curriculum at these schools was something else. It wasn't limited to the 3 R's, which is reading, writing, and arithmetic. It included geography and history and horticulture and physiology. When Mersey wrote her biography, she said she remembers looking at the geography books with pictures of New Zealand and Yellowstone National Park and the Fiji Islands, and she dreamed of seeing faraway places. Well, she completed her elementary school and high school. She went to Western Michigan Teachers College in Kalamazoo, and I love saying Kalamazoo. She became the first African-American student to be awarded a Bachelor of Arts from there, graduating in 27. She taught a while, and then in 1932, she entered Oxford University, where she would receive her Ph.D. She became a very distinguished scholar in European and diplomatic history. She wrote and she taught for many decades, and she died in 1997 at the age of 91. Having become a role model for serious young and old black men and women who were striving to prove the folly of prejudice and not being educated. And why did I pick Mersey Tate? Because she doesn't stand out anywhere else? Because she was a history teacher. The other name I want to talk to you about is Carter G. Woodson. Now, Carter was born to a poor family, but he was born after the Civil War was over. And he supported himself working in the coal mines of Kentucky, although he was born in Virginia. And he couldn't even go to high school until he was 20 years old. And once he did go, he only went 2 years and he graduated. Then he taught high school and he began to write articles. And he studied at home and he managed to save some money and went abroad. He actually received his Ph.D. from Harvard University in 1912. In 1915, he founded the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History because he had discovered when he was taking his history courses, there just wasn't much history around. He said that black history had been largely distorted or even neglected totally. The Journal of Negro History, he founded in 1916, and then he edited it for the next 30 years. He was a dean of the College of Liberal Arts and head of the graduate faculty at Howard University in Washington, D.C. That lasted 2 years. And after that, he was a dean of West Virginia State College for 2 more years. And while he was there, he founded and became the president of the Associated Publishers to bring out books on black life and culture. And since experience had shown him that the usual publishing outlets were rarely interested in anything scholarly, especially on blacks. In 1926, he helped found the Negro History Week. Of course, we now have it as the Black History Month, which is February. He died in 1950. It seems kind of strange. You know, we take the shortest month of the year to remember something that's really great. But Frederick Douglass was born in February. The 13th Amendment to the Constitution was signed in January, which took effect in February. So why did Woodson choose February? Do you think that could have anything to do with it? I don't know, but it's just a remarkable coincidence he chose February. So remember the names I've given you, Carter, Woodson, and Tate. Opportunities for self-expression. The New Deal, post-New Deal depression. During that time, what most people were trying to do was just stay alive from one day to the next, but trying to improve their lives too. And as strange as it may seem, we started seeing the writing and music and dance come alive again. It began during the Harlem Renaissance sometime before this, but now it's coming alive again. And jazz is no longer just heard in Harlem. It was thriving in New Orleans, in Memphis, and Chicago, and Detroit, San Francisco, Los Angeles. There wasn't a town that you could call itself a town that didn't have a jazz club. And everyone knew the names of the greats: Duke Ellington, Cab Calloway, Count Basie, big band jazz players. And I have a short YouTube of Duke Ellington. And with the big band era, of course, Louis Armstrong is still popular as ever, and Lionel Hampton, vibraphonist. And if you've never heard Lionel Hampton play on the vibraphone, I've got about a minute and a half of him too. It's really good. And of course, it wasn't just playing, there was a singing. There was Bessie Smith and Ethel Walters and Billie Holiday, Ella Fitzgerald, and the beautiful, extremely talented Lady Lena Horne. She is one of my favorite all-time ladies. Beautiful woman, and I have a little short YouTube of her singing. If you've never heard her perform, you're in for a treat. Now, these women performed on stage, on the radio, and they made recordings, and they performed live. Of course, the irony is the places they performed in, they weren't allowed to be served. They had to come in through the back door and leave the same way. A composer, performer, and promoter, Thomas A. Dorsey, is called the father of gospel success. He wrote and performed Precious Lord, Take My Heart. And I'm sure you've all sung that in church and had no idea that a black man wrote it in the 30s. Because by this time, gospel music is being performed not just in church, but in nightclubs and jazz festivals and concert halls. And I also have a short YouTube on Thomas Dorsey. I think it's a minute and a half. It's called A Brief History. It explains to you how he got into doing gospel music when he'd been playing in a jazz band. Bill Rose, the white theater producer, hired blacks to perform in the early 1940s. Names that you'd recognize, like Diana Carroll and Nat King Cole. They became very popular during this time because of their recordings. And FYI, Diane Carroll was the very first black woman to have a lead in a TV show. She was a nurse, and it didn't last long, but she opened the door. And with all the emphasis on popular music, we mustn't forget there was serious black writing going on. Symphonies were being written. And there were serious singers like Marian Anderson, who we talked about last time, acclaimed in Europe and America. But only in America was there a color line for performers. And of course, we discussed Eleanor Roosevelt resigning her membership in the Daughters of the American Revolution because they wouldn't allow Mrs. Anderson to sing at the Constitutional Hall. But after the 1960s, the serious black singers began to be more accepted in the Metropolitan in New York. Now, during this depression, the serious white writers were beginning to employ black themes in their own work. And even the new white writers were winning praise for their black themes. Meanwhile, the black writers were also publishing poems and novels. And over the next three decades, there's going to be an abundance of work published. And the one I've got up here is Ira Beauchamp. Because she didn't just write novels. She wrote children's books and historical novels. There was dozens and dozens of work done by both black and white writers in the 40s and 50s, and they all demonstrated black life in all its good, bad, and ugly. We could spend an entire semester just on the black writers. Now, some of the black writers went to Paris to write and live. For instance, James Baldwin, who he published about a half a dozen books, and his most famous work is Giovanni's Room. He published in 1956. And right before it published, he came out and declared his own homosexuality. Oh my God. Now folks, in the 1950s, that was definitely a no-no. You stayed in the closet. And if you being black wasn't bad enough in the South, a homosexual black, oh my God. It just, he stayed in Paris. Back to our story. But poetry and essays and novels, and there was also plays. And of course, one of the most famous plays is A Raisin in the Sun, produced in the late 1950s, I think it was 59 or 60, a story about the problems of a black family and their search for decent housing. The movie industry, like the rest of our country, was prejudiced, racist, and segregated. And black actors only got to play traditional roles, the maid, the babysitter, the gardener. Never a leading role, and usually very little speaking. There had been an effort to produce films about serious black life with black players, but it just wasn't received very well with the white public. And when Lena Horne, that beautiful, fantastic woman singer that I told you about, that you're going to have the privilege of listening to shortly, she had a part in several pictures, usually singing, and whenever the picture was shown in the southern states, her scenes would be cut out. We mustn't offend the white southerner, you know. It was a long uphill battle, but Lena Horne finally succeeded in getting to play roles with major producers and even was allowed to come in the front door a few times. So she got some doors open, another chance of small steps. But cooks, maids, criminals, common laborers, And of course, Hattie McDaniel, we talked about last time, receiving that Academy Award for Best Supporting Actors. And as successful as the black writer was, as successful as the black entertainer was, in the Hollywood industry, the black filmmaker just did not make it. And when you've been told all your life by parents and teachers and ministers and respectable members of the medical and educational community that the black man is inferior in every way, well, you believe it. And since water seeks its own level, so to speak, you want to be with people like you. After all, the slave was kept separate from the white man because he was a slave and he was different. But after slavery ended, we still believed we were superior. So we made up rules to keep the black man away from the white man, Jim Crow laws, and segregated society. So it's only natural that as a result of the segregation, the black community kept away from the white society and they developed their own society. And it's going to be different from the white one. Because even with freedom, there was no true freedom for the black man. Even with the tens of thousands of black men and women migrating to the North during the wars and after, they were kept separate. And with that separation came poor schools, poor housing, inadequate or non-existing recreational facilities, and of course, unemployment. Yet in spite of all the opposition from the white community, an educated middle class began to emerge. There was a social structure being formed, separate but different, and the one major difference to appear was the introduction of a new religion. Well, not really new, but new to us white middle class Americans, called the Nation of Islam, or Black Muslims. Elijah Poole, the son of a sharecropper, was born in poverty in Georgia on March 7, 1897. He quit school in the sixth grade and went to work in the fields and married a girl and had eight kids. 1923, he decides he can't take it anymore, so he takes the family and he moves to Detroit to work in the auto industry. And when he was there, he met a man named W.D. Fard, who had founded a black separatist movement called the Nation of Islam. He was well known for his controversial preachings, and he took Mr. Elijah under his wing. He converted to Islam, and he adopted Fard's teaching. He gave him a new name, Elijah Muhammad. So it was Wallace D. Fard that gave Elijah Poole the name Elijah Muhammad. He also taught him about a new way of life, and some of his doctrines identified the blacks as the original race and white people as devils created by a mad scientist, which I don't really understand. But some of the teachings stuff itself, such as self-reliance and clean living and the promise of a future in which blacks would no longer be oppressed, well, of course it had an appeal to the blacks. 1934, Mr. Fard mysteriously disappeared. The Nation of Islam split into several small rival fractions, and Muhammad moved a group of the followers to Chicago, where he established the Temple of Islam number 2, and this was going to be the headquarters of the religion. And he began to slowly spread the word of the Nation of Islam, steadily attracting new members. Things were going pretty good, and the war starts, and he avoids the draft, and so from 42 to 46, he was in jail. After his release, he returned to the leadership of the Nation of Islam. And then he declared that Fard had been an incarnation of Allah, and that he himself was now Allah's messenger. And over the next 30 years, Muhammad built the religion from a small fringe group into a very large and complex organization. Of course, it attracted controversy along with his new prominence. He continued to preach financial independence for black Americans, racial separation rather than integration, and a very strict code of moral behavior. He died of congestive heart failure on February 25, 1975, leaving behind a thriving religious movement with a membership of as high as 250,000 people. And I mean, not only there was temples and farms and bakeries and supermarkets and restaurants. So we can say that this black Muslim, Nation of Islam, it was more than a religious movement. It was also a political movement. And of course, we've all heard of Malcolm X. When I was growing up, we were taught to fear him because he was a radical and he hated white folks. And when I got into college and I read a biography of him and I went to see the movie with Denzel Washington, and I kind of think, you know, I've been badly misinformed. Malcolm X is an excellent speaker. And when he was in jail, he was found the faith of the Islam. When he got out, he joined the temple and became actually the second son, or the adopted son, or what do you want to call the favorite son, the man who was supposed to inherit the mantle when he died. He was a fantastic speaker. He drew large crowds, and he believed what he said. And he traveled to Africa and the Middle East and went to Mecca. And that was a bad thing to happen, because once he got over there, he had a change in thought. He thought, we don't have to preach separation. We need to teach inclusion. So he comes back, and he and Muhammad got into it, and he left and formed his own group. He repudiated the Nation of Islam's teachings. He said, we don't have to have separation. He continued to emphasize black self-determination and black defense, and he certainly disavowed racism. Great speaker. But in February of 1965, he was assassinated right before his speech by three of the members of the Nation of Islam. Well, at least it was suspected but never proven. 9 years later, the Nation of Islam has a policy change, and they begin to espouse some of Malcolm's ideas. The name was changed, and the organization was finally open to all people, not just blacks. But here again, this is another one of those things. We could talk for several class periods or the whole thing on the Nation of Islam. But whether it's Islam, Baptist, Methodist, or Catholics, the church was the mainstay in the black family. This was the one thing that they could control and own. But this is going to lead to internal problems, because not being able to participate in the affairs of other institutions, they would wind up fighting among themselves for leadership and doctrines. But even with internal disarray at times, the church didn't suffer. The memberships grew, and the wealth and power of the church grew. Now, some mainstream churches did try to integrate the black and white community, but the black church would and still remain strong and vibrant. And if you've ever been to a black church service, man, when you leave, you know you've been to church. But with their separate culture and churches, continue the black press, their circulations would continue to grow, and every African-American community seemed to have the desire to have their own paper. And after a while, a white newspaper just didn't give them the news they wanted or needed. Black news only made the papers when a black man was murdered, arrested, or convicted. A lynching didn't even make the papers. And by 1979, there were more than 350 black papers and magazines that were published on a regular scheduled basis. Now, after World War I, there was a need, and it was filled by professional blacks. Doctors, dentists, nurses, attorneys, construction workers, and the list goes on and on. And operating on the good old American custom, organizations of different professions begin to appear. And because of these organizations, the professionals begin to be able to have more influence, not only on the African American community, but the white community as well. Now, most organizations, like the Boy Scouts, the Girl Scouts, the YMCA, and the YWCA, they had been pretty much segregated until the 1920s. And even then, African Americans were not encouraged to join after the 1920s. It's going to be the Masons, the Odd Fellows, and I love this title, the Improved, Benevolent, and Protective Order of Elks of the World. They're going to offer membership. Now, we've talked about the separation of the black and the white cultures, and it was almost a necessity, but it wasn't really accepted. Because remember how the black men who were being trained as officers in World War I and II were sent to an all-black training camp, and how they objected, saying it would promote further segregation? Well, that's just what has happened. There are many people, black and white, that have cried out at the separation, because it just causes further separation. It would be the National Negro Congress, organized in 1936, that put up the most vigorous attempts to eliminate the isolation. They worked hard and had hundreds of organizations to help, but by 1940, it began to lose its members because they're being accused of being a front for communists. Of course, at this point in time during the war, if you weren't red, white, and blue, you were communist or red. The Southern Negro Youth Congress was formed in 1930. It only lasted until 1937. They had several different types of youth organizations, and their purpose was to help the young African-American when he had difficulty. But they weren't too successful. They did protest segregated schools, and they eventually won a court battle in Virginia against segregation on the buses. But trying to eradicate the racial barriers does not indicate there was a lack of black pride. After all, Carter G. Wilson can come up with the idea of the Black History Week, it's now Black History Month, because people need to learn about it. There were many awards created for outstanding blacks. I mean, the blacks had respect for their leaders, the famous and even the infamous. There was no area where blacks were not making accomplishments in medicine, science, education, writing, and even sports. I mean, Jackie Robinson. But since the opportunities were so few, the accomplishments always seemed larger than life. So should we have one world or two? At the end of the Civil War, in all honesty, our country had the opportunity to make massive social changes. And we dropped the ball badly. The white Southerner had been forced to figure out how and what to do with all those newly freed blacks. The freed men could not make the decisions. It was up to the white community. But by not allowing them to become integrated, the black men and women had to be forced to develop their own world or culture. And when the unprepared, newly freed black men got into trouble, it just reinforces the notion of the, I told you so. There are going to be numerous sociological studies on the effects of the separation of races and how to bridge the gap, which is what we started out the chapter with. The treatment of African Americans was America's greatest scandal, and almost universal rejection of the African American was, well, it's a denial of our own profession of faith and equality of humanity. And when you firmly believe you are superior, there can be no equality. But there were efforts to improve the race relations. A group of black and white Southerners, yes, I said Southerners, organized something called the Southern Regional Council. Their published policy statement was that the Negro in the United States should have a guarantee of equal opportunity that every other citizen has. And they worked so hard to gain both political and economic equality for the Southern African American. The Southern Conference for Human Welfare, organized 5 years earlier in 1938, they had stayed as well as local chapters, and they attempted to generate interest in discrimination, a law against lynching, and a poll tax, and and it was accused of having left-wing leanings and listed as a subversive group by the House Committee on Un-American Activities. In the Midwest, the American Council on Race Relations, established in 1944, it had a trained staff of white and black, but it was primarily consulting. They advised other people on how to establish programs. And by the 1950s and 60s, things seemed to be turning around. An honest effort to educate the public and the school children about the bad effects of prejudice and discrimination against blacks was underway. It was at this time that the Head Start program was begun. And also there was an effort to erase the negative images of Americans, African Americans, and they began to demand that textbooks include more information of black history. And there is just not nearly enough, very little black histories in American history books. It's better now than when I started teaching several decades ago, but it's still not enough. So think about all the names of black Americans doing great things and inventing things, professionals you'd never heard of before you came to this class. And I'm not just talking about entertainers or movie star people. I'm talking about real, honest-to-earth, down-to-earth people. Yeah, I got an announcement. Now, I am aware that you were given a couple of days off for fall break. But I teach at more than one school, and I'm doing my best to coordinate all of them being off at the same time. So beginning on the 13th of October through the 20th of October, there's going to be a Mrs. Graves fall break. In other words, no assignment. Oh, you could work on your book report if you want to or not. I will open your next assignment on October the 20th, and it will not be due until the 27th of October. Now, don't forget to turn this one in, because this one will be due the 13th. So between the 13th and 20th, you have no assignment, and the assignment that comes in, then you've got another week to do it. It's also a good time, if you have missed an assignment, to get with me about making it up. Otherwise, enjoy your time away from me. And thank you for listening.